Hi, I'm Toby and welcome to The Joy of Mathematics. All you will need to be able to follow along at home is a pen, some paper and a vision in your mind. Today we're going to be exploring the square root of I. It's a curious question with a delightful answer. Don't let the mathematics scare you away. I'm here to walk through every step with you. Talent is just pursued interest. Anything that you're willing to practice, you can do. I is our favorite imaginary friend, but our relationship with them is complicated. It's mostly their fault. In fact, I is a complex friend. If we use a smiley face to refer to all of our complex friends, we can write them as X plus IY, where X and Y give the address of our friend on the real and imaginary axis. Real friends can be complex too. They just have a y value of 0, and it's our y on this axis and our x down here. If we draw a straight line between the origin and where our friend is, we can call that r, and it actually allows us to set up some triangles in here, where this angle here is theta. Using a bit of trigonometry, we can actually rewrite expressions for x and y using sine and cosine. So x will be this distance here, and it will be r cosine of theta. Y, this one here, will be r sine of theta. Now, if you've seen my first Joy of Mathematics video, you may remember something called Euler's formula, and it was a very beautiful expression. I'll remind you of it here. It is e to the I theta is equal to cosine theta plus I sine theta. Now, you may see that we're dealing with this already. We have a cosine theta plus I sine theta in here. So actually, we can use Euler's formula to rewrite this expression up here. I'll get rid of it since we now know what we can do. There we go, and just beat the Euler out of it. Friend is going to be R e to the I theta. If we just want to talk about our friend I for a second, we can get rid of all this general case. Well, I is going to be up here at a distance of 1 from the origin. That in fact places I on the unit circle, which are the points that are all a distance of 1 away from the origin. Don't know how good I'm drawing a circle today, but there we go, good enough. To write down I like this, we know that r is going to be equal to 1, but what is theta going to be? One way to find theta would be going like this, up from the real axis to our imaginary axis. Now, if 2 pi radians is the rotation it takes to get all the way around the circle, then this quarter of a rotation right here will be pi over 2. Now there's another way to write I, and that's by rotating around this way. Now likewise, this one is going to be e to the minus this time, because we're rotating the other way, I, and it's going to be 3 pi over 2. It's time for a friendship test here, and we want to test to see that if the square root of our complex friend is written like this, what's the solution going to be? Is he complex? Can we trust him? I don't know. We can say that the square root of any complex friend is some other number z. Now, if we make both of these guys a little bit more square, a little bit more uptight, we can write complex friend is equal to z squared. Now, if we subtract this from this, arrange everyone to equal 0, we get z squared minus our complex friend is equal to 0. Now this might not look like much, but it's actually kind of important for us. What we have here is a polynomial. It's a polynomial with a degree 2, it's a quadratic. And that means that we can use something called the FTA. Now I know what you're thinking, but this is not Friendly Trees Anonymous. Instead, this is the Fundamental Theorem of Algebra. The Fundamental Theorem of Algebra means that any polynomial with complex coefficients will have complex solutions. Now, do we have complex coefficients here? Well, our coefficient in front of the z squared term is 1. We don't have a z term on its own, so the b, as it's usually called, is 0. And this is our constant term here. And the coefficient of our constant term is our complex friend. So we do have complex coefficients. Therefore, we know that the answer to the square root of I will be a complex number 2. In fact, we know that there will be 2 solutions because this gives us a polynomial of degree 2. This is just useful to know, so we know how to write and treat our answer as we're going forwards. Now, back to I. You might know that the square root of a number can be written as that number to the power of 1/2. So we could write the square root of I as I to the power of 1/2. And then we can just do the same thing to these terms. We would have e to the I pi over 2 to the power of 1/2. I'm writing or for these two solutions. E to the minus I, 3 pi over 2 to the power of 1/2. To work these out, just bring this exponent inside of this one and multiply them out. We would get e to the I pi over 4. And e to the minus I, 3 pi over 4. Now we can actually find these solutions on our unit circle over here. So a theta of pi over 4, it's going to be halfway up here. That's going to be our first solution to the square root of I. Our next solution will be minus 3/4 pi, which would place us opposite over here. That's what our two solutions look like graphically. Now I've made a little bit more room for ourselves, so we can then take these answers that we've already found graphically, and if you choose to, convert them back into the original form. We just do that using the reverse of Euler's formula, so putting them back into sine and cosine. For our first solution, we would have theta is pi over 4, so we would have cosine pi over 4 plus I sine pi over 4. Now, cosine of pi over 4 actually works out to 1 over root 2, and in a similar way, we would have plus I times the sine of that, which is also 1 over root 2. So that is actually our first solution to the square root of I. Now, you could do the exact same thing using a negative 3/4 pi as, you know, our argument in here, or you can look at our visual plot and know that if this was our first solution, our second solution will be the negative of both of these values because we're in the opposite quadrant here on the graph. So our second solution will just be minus 1 over root 2 minus I 1 over root 2. And those will be our two solutions, as shown there, for the square root of I. Now the dislikes on this video might come from people who are upset I didn't rationalize this denominator. You could rewrite these fractions as root 2 over 2, I believe, but they look cute enough as they are to me. These solutions kind of make sense if you think about it visually. For example, this rotation from here to here, if you repeat it once again, you get to I. And same with this one here. You repeat this rotation again, you get back to I. So that's how you find the square root. If you wanted to find the cube root, you would end up with 3 equally spaced solutions, where if you repeat them twice more, you get back to I. And you can even try finding out the cube root of I. It's a very similar technique, although you might want to think twice about how you find the two, I guess, definitions of eye, instead of like this way and this way, you might want to just keep adding on 2π or a full rotation every time you're trying to define I to get the number of solutions you need. Thank you for joining me here today in the garden, and I hope you have an absolutely mathematical day. This is Henry, and he's jealous that Skittles got included in one of my previous videos but he didn't, so now's his time for a video. Thank you.